Hey everyone, it's Eric from Rosetree, outstanding in a soybean field. Harvest is underway, which means that soil testing is going to come quick, and I want to spend a few minutes with you talking about soil testing and what to think about this fall. First, you're going to want to think about who you want to do that soil testing job for you. There's a lot of people out there doing soil testing. We do a ton of soil testing. One of the things that sets us apart is just our objectivity. You know, we're not out there trying to sell you products or trying to make a commission on fertilizer sales. We're out there trying to educate you on what your fields need and how we're going to position manure and fertilizer to achieve a high yield without overspending and really working within your budget. So in this video, I wanted to just talk a little bit about what to look for soil testing, how to make sure that the person doing your soil testing is doing it right, and some of the other outcomes that we see when we work with our customers. So we're going to take a walk out in the field and see what's going on. There's a lot to think about when we're doing soil testing for people, and you can kind of break down soil testing into two categories: precision ag soil testing and traditional composite soil testing. Up until a few years ago, we would have done this field as a traditional composite soil sample. You know, the soil sampling we've been doing for the past 40 years, where you go out into a field and you're going to grab 10 or 15 cores in that field and combine those cores into one sample and get a fertilizer read. And you can kind of see in this particular field, we've got a different landform up on the hill. There's different soils down at the bottom. You get down to where I'm standing and there's undulating landscape. There's just a lot of variability in this field that it's hard to capture with a traditional soil testing program. So what we've been doing is just dividing this field into quarters and trying to capture some variability that way. Now we're in a position in this field where we have enough yield data to go and do some precision ag soil testing. And precision ag soil testing can be done a handful of different ways. And it's really important that you're working with your agronomist, if you're working with your Rosetree agronomist, or you're working with your fertilizer salesman, to make sure that those zones are developed correctly. So precision ag soil testing in this field is going to look a lot different than your run-of-the-mill standard composite soil testing that we've been doing forever. First thing that I want people to do is figure out how they're going to soil test this field. Are you going to do it in a grid? Are you going to do it using some multi-year yield analysis? What layers do you have available to you that you can get good information in to make sure that this soil testing is done correctly and is going to give you the biggest benefit that you can out of the investment you make in soil testing? So if I'm doing a grid here, right, I'm probably going to do it in a 2-acre grid, eastern Pennsylvania. Don't go much more than a 2-acre grid, or else the variability that's within your soils really starts to show and you just don't get great information. We'll use grids a couple of different ways. I'll use grids for farms that don't have the historic yield data on their farm. Maybe they have 1 or 2 years worth of yield data, but it's not really enough to create a multi-year yield analysis. So we'll use grids in that situation to make sure that we're adequately connecting the variability to the applications that we want to make. It's very rare that I'm just taking a field and putting a 2-acre grid on it and going to town, because there's always modifications that you're going to want to make to that grid. And those modifications that you make to the grid when you're doing precision ag soil testing come from the individual doing the testing for you and the knowledge they have on your fields, and making sure that we're not positioning a grid point on a rock outcropping or in a drainage ditch or some other thing that's going to have just an adverse impact on how that prescription is developed on your farm. So definitely take the time with your agronomist or whoever is doing that work and make sure that those grids are set up properly, because you can manipulate points, you can add points. We'll add a lot of times we'll add points to our grids to capture variability that we know is there from the scouting work that we do, or variability from NDVI imagery that we'll bring in and overlay on that grid. It's very easy to take a grid layer and overlay a topography map, overlay a soils map, overlay an EC map, overlay anything onto that grid so that you can modify points and add points to adequately show the variability that you're hoping to capture from grid sampling. But you got to take the time in order to get that layer right before you go out and do the soil sampling. Doing the soil sampling is completely easy. So next thing I want you to think about, if you're not going to do grid sampling, what are you going to do? And if you don't have grid, if you have enough yield data, right, your combine has 3 to 5 years of yield data on it, we're ready to start putting that yield data together for you and doing some multi-year layers, right? So you're going to take anywhere from 4 to 6 years worth of yield data. It could be any crop, right? It could be corn, it could soybeans, could be wheat. As long as we have yield data, we can bring it in and we can normalize that yield and create some layers out of it to do a multi-year zone. Please keep in mind that the zone we develop for soil testing may not be the zone that you use for variable rate seeding. You may need two different zones or two different zone maps, and that's okay. We can help you out with that too, but we're just talking about creating a zone that is economical and beneficial for soil testing, completely different than creating a zone that is economical and beneficial for variable rate seeding. So if we're going to do variable rate soil testing or precision soil testing, using multi-year yield analysis, spend the time to make sure that your data is good, go through it, make sure that all the messiness is cleaned up and that those layers of yield data are as accurate as you can get them to be, and then make sure that you're not using the outliers, right? If you had a severe drought last year, maybe don't use that year in creating your zones. If you had like the best year of corn that you've ever had, maybe don't use that layer for zone creation either, because both of those extremes are going to affect how a zone is created and how you end up soil testing that. So just be really careful with that. When we're creating multi-year zones, it's not uncommon for us to bring in some additional layers. Like I said, anything that you can do to help enhance your knowledge of variability in the field, whether it's a drone layer, an NDVI layer, an EC layer, don't be afraid to bring them in to your multi-year yield analysis to see how they influence the zone development. After you get your zones developed, soil testing is fairly straightforward. One of the biggest issues we see with people and companies out there doing zone development is that they'll go to one point within that zone and take a soil sample and then create their recommendations based on one soil sample taken in that zone. When you establish zones, think of them as fields, right? You're going to go into a zone and you're going to get 10 to 15 soil cores within that zone, mix it all together, and get a representative sample. Just because we established zones in your field does not mean that we've captured all of the variability in every square inch of that zone is uniform, because it's not, right? There's still a lot of variability that is occurring within those zones. Your way of overcoming that variability is just taking a good representative soil sample. So whoever's out doing the work for you, make sure that once they spend the time creating a good zone, they're going to send somebody out in the field to do good work for you in developing or taking that soil test. So you get your soil test results back, and now you're ready to roll in prescriptions. This is maybe one of the differentiation things between having an independent crop consultant do your work for you versus having a fertilizer company do it for you. We're going to come out, we're going to sit down with you, we're going to explain what the soil test results mean. We're going to ask you what your fertilizer budget is. That's a differentiator between like an independent crop consultant and a fertilizer salesman, is our objectivity and really our ability to sit down with you and ask questions and just make sure that we're getting it right. I don't want you to go out and do a variable rate fertilizer application on land that you know you're going to lose next year and not take that into consideration. So lots of things to think about when you're out doing soil testing or when you're getting ready for soil testing, but guys, it's time. Here we are in September, and this is going to go pretty quick. Do yourselves a favor. Reach out to your Rosetree agronomist. Let's get these precision soil testing acres lined up, because